Hey, remember the crowd video about me? Oh, you don't remember? No, it's because it's never been made. When you're down to threatening, it's because you don't have the goods.
So, a few weeks ago, JF made a video attacking IQ, and now I'm finally getting around to respond. It was a real expectations violation to see him make the arguments that he made, and it kind of shocked me to see those words coming out of his mouth. I had thought a lot differently of him. I thought he understood basic statistical concepts. I thought he understood not just IQ, but what a predictor is in general. I thought he had a level of general intelligence, at least, to see that what he's making, that this, for example, is not an argument against anything. There's also the possibility that JF is literally just lying because he has other reasons to oppose IQ and the G factor and has some reason to lead his audience to oppose IQ and the G factor. But you'll see these are really unbelievable errors that JF is making. And I'm still half suspecting that someone's going to tell me that this is all a prank. But assuming it's not, let's dive in here.
No measure that fails 60 to 95% of the time should be part of science, nor should psychology, owing to its sinister track record, be part of science. Rather, scientism. But that's another discussion. All right, I agree with this point. Fair point. Psychology is absolutely ridiculous. It has led to no insight. It is a bunch of constructs by academics, and I don't know of any subfield of of psychology that does fit as a hard science that would be respectable. I have no respect for psychology. I have no respect for sociology, at least in their current implementation. Now, is it a possible? Can we imagine a psychology or a sociology that would work? Yes, I think we can. So I think I would say the current implementation of these sciences are unscientific, but who knows, we could have a good science eventually out of these fields.
So another thing JF likes to do is mock psychology. Now, this goes back to the question, what makes science? And the answer has to be predictive validity. The ability to make meaningful predictions, bonus points if you have novel and counterintuitive predictions. This is something that I thought JF and I educated crowd about 1 year ago. Because if your standard isn't what works, then what are you going by? Are you just going by which theory has more math, has more beakers, has more science machines, has more brains MRI machines, a vaguely positive perception by the public or by people who work in other fields? We had this debate with Kraut on the Find the Genes crap. You may personally like molecular genetics research because it seems more sciencey to you, more test tubes, gene sequencing, and the promise of understanding the role and function of every single SNP. But then we pointed out that in terms of being able to actually predict adult IQ, that heritability estimates from ye olde twin studies and from longitudinal studies and from component analysis and other quantitative genetics methods, they still predict better, like four times as better, four times more gooder predictions. So he repeats this old saw about replication in psychology only being around 50%, which if you're a noob, will seem like a big deal. But first off, this isn't much worse than other fields. For example, a 2005 series of replication attempts for drug studies found a 44% replication rate. A 2012 analysis by Begley and Ellis found that only 11% of preclinical cancer studies could be replicated. Here's a fun one, brain scan studies. A 2014 research report looked at 17 structural brain behavior correlation studies, and in each replication attempt, they took the same people used in the original studies. Used either MRI or DWI, whichever the studies used, and they had a replication rate of 0% from those 17 studies. And that's totally fitting, because when people think of science, brain scan images now are what first pop into people's minds. It's no longer the planets, it's no longer the solar system, but now it's those brain scan images. The poster image of Science TM is literally the worst. It's perfect. That said, if you want to say that psychology is pseudoscience because it only replicates 50% of the time, well, Nature conducted a survey of scientists and asked them to estimate the replication rates for their own field. So we have physics at the top at 73%, medicine at 55%. Okay, so is medicine bunk? It's 5% higher than psychology, but is 55%, is that enough higher to where it's valid, but 50% is too low, so it's pseudoscience. Now, if the replication rate has to be 60%, then, well, I'm sorry, JF, but biology is out. So is engineering, medicine, and earth and environmental sciences. If the bar is at 70%, well, then out goes material science, out goes astronomy and chemistry, wow. And if you put the bar at 75%, then, well, geez, I guess we're done with physics. Now, Taleb's an empty head, so he's gonna just repeat this, whatever. But JF might have a few brain cells to rub together, so I'll ask you, JF, what's the required replication rate for a field to be a science? Now, to the audience, the reason replication rates are so low is because research tends to be done on the margins, on boundary-breaking things. They're pushing the limits. They're doing studies about things that are debated in their field. They're not constantly publishing studies reaffirming the basic tenets that are all agreed upon. So there's a very easy way for a field to have a very high replication rate in their studies, and that is simply don't take risks. Just do boring studies showing everything that we already know, and you'll have a replication rate of 99.99%, and you will make no advances in your field. Because if you're taking risks, you're sticking it out there, doing risky studies, well then your replication rates are gonna be lower. Now, another reason replications are lower has to do with certain methodological problems to the studies, and that's bad, but don't take replication rate as the end-all be-all, because research being published is not the central tenets of the field. The research being published is on those areas that are on the margins that are debated. That said, if you know a single psychology paper says thing, and you don't know anything about the study, that it's just a psychology paper saying thing, well, odds are, about 50%, that thing is true. Now, that's far more likely than some random theory formulated by somebody that somebody just cooked up. So if you see thing published in a psychology journal, oh, well, there's about a 50-50 chance that thing is true. But on top of this, actual researchers are able to correctly predict about 75% of the time which papers are going to replicate. And if you ask them with degrees of confidence, which papers are they 80 to 90% confident, I'm sure that number would be 90%, that researchers would be able to predict with about 90% accuracy what papers could replicate, although that's a bit of speculation on my part. Now, I'm sorry if this is distressing to Science TM people who want certainty, who want magic machines to produce certainty, like in Star Trek, but part of being an adult is learning that Star Trek is fantasy and outgrowing Science TM. Another thing Taleb says, and that JF dumbly nods in agreement with, is when Taleb claims psychology studies are underpowered. And again, there have been meta-analytic reviews of various fields and the mean power of studies in those fields. Button et al. From 2013 finds neuroscience at 21%, brain imaging at 8%, Sucks and Ioannidis find cognitive neuroscience at 14%, psychology at 23%, and medical at 23%. Ooh, and look at that, cognitive neuroscience, neuro. Guys, it's neuro, cognitive neuroscience, the most fucking Science TM thing there is. So what did JF get his PhD in? Oh, neuro science. Oh, what's this? Less statistical power than psychology. Those underpowered. Well, geez, JF, if psychology is statistically underpowered, well, then you're then. Well, maybe that's why you got out of academia, because you realize that. No. And what happens when we just look at intelligent research in psychology? What does the statistical power look like there? Oh, wow, it's like the highest thing. It's literally the best. And keep in mind, JF wasn't just shitting on psychology in general, which beats his field. He was shitting on particularly the part of psychology that has 2.5 times the statistical power than his field. Get dunked on, you scrub. But here's another thing to consider. If you were to peel the onion back further and limit your criteria to the best intelligence studies, the ones which guys like Richard Lynn compiles and which we use in debates, those are going to be well above this on statistical power. And the replications, especially for race and IQ, are just out the bazinga for race and IQ studies, especially the ones we use. And for you to appreciate just how abnormally strong the case is for race and IQ compared to other fields, this is something that I can show you here statistically. It's only something you truly begin to appreciate after reading thousands of studies. Okay? Just after reading, you just have to read thousands of studies and become intuitively familiar with the effect sizes and sample sizes in most studies and how much related literature most papers have compared to intelligence research and group differences in intelligence research. And that's why it's still here despite enormous ideological opposition to both intelligence research and particularly group differences in intelligence research, and why it survived this long, simply because the case is so overwhelming. But Taleb and JF's attitude of dismissing something because it's from a particular field, this is incredibly dangerous. It's this idea that you should be more trusting of those fields labeled science, and that you should just dismiss stuff from a field labeled not science. How about you just be discerning about research, and in general, look for things like replication, transparent methods, comprehensively presenting data, and let's not hand wave away entire fields. In fact, when you're looking at research, one thing to sort of keep in mind is that what is a field? Because every research paper is particular. And really, at root, there's no such thing as a neuroscience paper. It's just a paper running an experiment, and the experiment is either well done or it's not well done. The psychology experiment is either well done or it's not well done. What field the paper is in is not relevant to any of this.
Well, as far as I can tell, he cannot even reveal his own face in the Final Fantasy fictive universe.
Well, one thing you probably don't know is that I'm wearing no pants right now.
I have a doctorate in neuroscience and mathematical computational neuroscience.
I went to college!
And here I am, stuck with a high schooler. What the fuck? Why the fuck do I have to endure this as an intellectual? That's not how they treated Galileo. That's not how they treated all of the intellectuals in France. Never have we had to deal with high schoolers coming back from the past, threatening us. What the fuck is this? If you want to detect how someone fares at a task, say, loan sharking, tennis playing, or random matrix theory, make him or her do that task. We don't need theoretical exams for a real-world function by probability-challenged psychologists. Traders get it right away. Hypothetical trading from simulated paper strategies doesn't count. Performance equals actual. What goes on in people's head or reaction to a screen image doesn't exist, except via negativa. The kind of folk conception of intelligence does refer to this ability to do well in the world. And this is certainly not what IQ measures, because the correlation is loose, precisely because we mentioned earlier, it's anywhere between 13 and 50% for specific jobs. It's certainly not a highly correlated measure. Real life.
Taleb says, and JF agrees, that IQ tests are pointless as predictors of work performance and life outcomes, and that simple work sample tests are better than IQ tests at predicting work performance. And over any extended period of time past 1 month, IQ is a better predictor. And there's meta-analyses on these. The Hunter and Hunter had like 80-something studies. In the very short term, under 2 weeks, a work sample test is sometimes more predictively valid than IQ. But over at least 3 months, IQ is going to win. In fact, work sample tests are beaten out by quite a few things. So just on the simple facts, Taleb and JF are wrong. But not only are they wrong, but their point is stupid. Because the point about IQ is that it adds predictive value over and above other things. Even if work sample tests were more predictive than IQ, well, so what? Why not use both? The NFL requires a Wonderlic IQ test for players entering the draft. It's just treated as another metric that they evaluate the players on. But golly, doesn't the NFL know that past performance and physical combine results are far more important than an IQ test? Well, sure they know, but that's not the relevant question. The question is, does the IQ test add enough prediction power to be worth the effort of administering it? And the NFL's decision on that has been yes, even if it predicts, say, only 5% of the variation in performance for any given position, that's probably worth it given how cheap and easy the test is to administer. I don't get this bizarre monocausal thinking that JF and Taleb are engaging in. Taleb brings up China as an example of IQ not necessarily leading to economic success, and this argument is an insult to everyone. Yes, we all know that China exists, and we know that the United Arab Emirates exists. Imagine being like Taleb, trying to find the one cause for everything. Oh, IQ only explains about 40% of the variance between countries and national GDPs. That's not the cause. Better throw it out. Imagine being that retarded. But on top of that, human behavior is multifactorial. The reality is that people do lots of things for lots and lots of reasons, each one explaining a small amount of the variance in life decisions and outcomes, and IQ is just one of those variables that you use. Of course, it is far and away the best general predictor in social science. IQ is almost always in contention as the top predictor in just about every life outcome. But I don't understand this rule for any statistical prediction rule has to what? Explain the majority of variance? Or I guess when it explains half the variance, Taleb says that's not enough because you're quote unquote wrong half the time. Whatever the hell that even means. Like when Taleb points to, say, a variable explaining 40% of the variance in something, and he says that means it's wrong 60% of the time, that's not true. That's not how that works. That's not how a correlation works. That's not what it means. Like, why are you so stupid, Taleb? Like, really, like, as I was recording this, it just sort of dawned on me just how profoundly dumb that is to think that a correlation of 0.4 means that it's a correct prediction 40% of the time. I mean, is this guy supposed to be some sort of smart person? Isn't this guy supposed to be some sort of professor, some sort of groundbreaking researcher or something? And yet he's saying something that a guy taking an intro to statistics class would probably understand as BS. That's not what a correlation means. It means the explanation of variance. It's not a prediction. A correlation is not a prediction. It just tells you the strength of a relationship. It's not the prediction itself. Again, I'm just like, this is something weird. And JF didn't notice this. Like, I feel like I'm in the Twilight Zone.
And often people do the fallacy to think, oh, well, I measured the average IQ of liars, and it's 120-something or 110-something. Therefore, there are jobs that require higher IQ. Well, not so fast. I mean, you may end up with some professions filled with high IQ people who have been selected through another process than the fact that this job requires high IQ. Because what leads to a job often is a set of unions, of protective mechanism from the state, such as state exams and passing through a university, therefore having parents that have enough money in the US, for example, to send you through that university, or in a socialist country like Canada, just having desires to go through the university. And these things will end up being selecting events that have nothing to do with your ability to be a liar, but they end up selecting you for your high IQ. So I totally agree with this first part.
JF says this bizarre, uncharacteristic pablum about lifetime earnings being a function of connections and school quality. Well, Regarding school quality, there has been research that straightforwardly shows that lifetime earnings are not related to the selectivity of the school you went to once you start controlling for a bunch of traits about the students themselves, including IQ, SAT score, high school grades, and other indicators of work ethic. From Mueller 1988, quote, "The difference in squared correlations indicated that for men, selectivity explained only 0.21%, for women, 0.4% of the total variability in income above and beyond the controls. Note that the zero order correlation between selectivity and income was 0.07 for males and 0.11 for females." From Thomas, 2000, quote, "Holding all student characteristics constant, graduates from private institutions enjoy a slight 4% earnings advantage over public college graduates. Moreover, graduates from colleges with selectivity scores 100 points higher than comparison colleges averaged a 1% earnings premium," close quote. Now, 100 points on the selectivity scale that they're using here would be most of the operational scale that Thomas was looking at, with the boundaries before just saying greater than or less than being 144 points apart. So maybe if you go from the absolute worst accredited college to the most elite university in the US, maybe we're looking at a 2% increase when you control for all student characteristics. The problem, though, is that at those ranges, you may not get any students with similar characteristics going in. But shoot, let's be generous. Let's say it's 5% between the extreme points here. From Kruger, 2002, quote, "After we adjust for students' unobserved characteristics, our findings lead us to question the view that school selectivity, as measured by the average SAT score of the freshmen who attend a college, is an important determinant of students' subsequent incomes. Students who attend more selective colleges do not earn more than other students who were accepted and rejected by comparable schools but attended less selective colleges." So at least within the US regarding universities, no, that doesn't appear to really matter. It doesn't appear to be a golden ticket. What seems to matter is the people who go in. And also, as an aside, this is also why there's sort of this belief that blacks and Hispanics are discriminated against in the labor force, because even though they're going to these elite institutions, they're not getting paid more. And just the reality is that the private sector hasn't really given elite institutions themselves much of a premium for a very long time. But anyway, what about other kinds of connections? Because JF wasn't just talking about universities. Well, I usually just say familial, ethnic, or social group connections can be shown to play a relatively minor role by just pointing to IQ to income correlations. But JF here is saying, well, IQ is coincidental with knowing the right people to get the jobs. Now, first off, this is just, you know, JF says it, asserts without evidence, and it can be dismissed without evidence. We could do that. But let's go do a little bit better than that. We can look at immigrants to the U.S. over generations. And we can see here, this is from Pew, Mexican immigrants go up a bit, Central Americans stay around the same, Asians go up a bit, European immigrants go up a lot, Caribbeans go down a bit, and Africans go down a bit over the generations. I mean, are we saying that African immigrants had more connections relative to all other immigrant groups in 1970 than they do in 2013? This is usually what happens with environmental explanations for general social economic phenomena. They sound nice at first, but then the undulations of the data just rip them apart over time. And the only explanations that reliably survive the undulations of the data constantly are coming in are hereditary explanation, right? A mixed genetic environmental explanation for anything, having that flexibility. And I don't understand the desire to throw out IQ and just grasp at any other explanations you can. I mean, it's just so weird. And while, sure, it could just be some big fat coincidence that IQ has a persistent non-causal relationship with all of these things that also have a correlation with various life outcomes, and that IQ, or whatever it is IQ is measuring, is not causing anything, it's just coincidental, that could be the case. But if we're trying to be parsimonious here, then you have to say that it looks like IQ is doing something, or whatever IQ is measuring is doing something.
He's claiming that there are things in there that look essentially for your obedience. Well, I actually agree that it could be the case. I'd like to see some data demonstrating this. I don't think Nassim will be providing data, but he's at least putting the claim there. Paper shufflers, obedient people. Absolutely. That is my impression from being in the academic system, at least. The higher I got into the academic system, the less I had this spirit of revolt in people around me. And I was the kind of intellectual who questions everything. And I didn't feel I was surrounded by people like me. I felt like I had a bunch of soldiers of intellectual thought that were just good at recording stuff. Now, I have to say that this has been released a little bit when I reached PhD level and postdoctoral level, and when I ended up in top universities in the US. I found that this whole obedience thing is mostly true and maximally true at the undergrad level in universities. It's the richness, it's not the IQ. 3. It takes a certain type of person to waste intelligent concentration on classroom and academic problems. These are lifeless bureaucrats who can muster sterile motivation. Some people can only focus on problems that are real, not fictional textbook ones. See the note below where I explain that I can only concentrate with real, not fictional problems. Yeah, that is true. To be caring about these fictional textbook problems selects for a certain type of personality. And there are other types of personality that will do extremely well if they have to find how to sell this car. But they cannot be bothered by finding a theoretical response on which no income is linked.
Taleb says, and JF agrees, that people with high IQ don't take risks and are just conformist drones. Well, there are studies on this. In 2016, Anderson et al. Did a little meta-analysis on cognitive ability, or we'll just say IQ, and risk aversion. And they found the results were mostly non-significant, but more studies showed that high IQ people were slightly less risk averse, meaning higher IQ people were more likely to take risks, both financially, in terms of their career, and personally. In 2017, with a sample of 11,000 twins, Beauchamp found a positive association between risk-taking and cognitive ability. In 2015, Levine and Rubinstein found a positive correlation between someone being an entrepreneur and their IQ. In 2004, Judge and Colbert found a slightly positive relationship between IQ on both their probability of becoming and effectiveness as a leader in a variety of settings. In addition, libertarians and atheists have historically had higher IQs, and historically being a libertarian and an atheist have been non-conformist positions, although that might be changing recently. Certainly in the past that was not the case, and when it was not the case, it was positively correlated with a higher IQ. So no, higher IQ on average probably makes you less of a slave. And in fact, there's a reason to think this would be the case. If you're not a very smart person, that you don't have a whole lot of raw brain power, thinking for yourself could be a bad idea. That if you're not very smart, if you don't understand things, you tend to use social cue heuristics and authority markers. A low IQ person really cares about things like peer review. They really care about things like professor titles. They really care about these sort of markers of authority, because they don't have the ability to actually sift through the information itself, so they follow leaders. Whereas people who are more intelligent can actually sift through the information themselves and don't need to use these heuristic tools. And this is probably why higher IQ people are less conformist and less of a natural slave. Now, in terms of real-world situational judgment, McDaniel et al. Did a meta-analysis of 79 previous studies, which had a correlation between IQ and scores on situational judgment tests, and found a mean correlation of 0.46, which is pretty big. For an intuitive understanding of how profound that correlation is, the correlation between the sex-adjusted height of your parents, averaged, and an offspring's height is around 0.5. And so the correlation between the height of your parents and you, sex-adjusted, is about 0.5. So a 0.46 correlation between IQ and scores on situational judgment test, this is a really big deal. This is going to have a viscerally noticeable effect in the real world. And if you want to say that high IQ people lack situational judgment, well, we can look at accident rates by IQ. And sure, there's a cutoff, and there's only relevant variation at lower IQs. And we can look at just life outcomes, showing that high IQ people tend to have what we would consider better life outcomes. So is life not a one large, long-running situational judgment test? So literally everything said about the traits of IQ by Taleb and JF is refuted by whatever research is done on it, if there is research done on it. and JF cites his own personal experience in academia. Now, first off, JF, don't be so quick to assume that the academics you were working with even had that high of IQs. Okay, there's a lot of research showing that most people who work in at a university in some capacity don't have IQs approaching 120. In addition, academia is the one place that we know selects for high-ish IQs. High-ish IQ, not as high as a lot of people think. But it does select for high-ish IQs, but also appears to select for conformity. But that's just my impression. My impression, JF, is that you spent years in a place that selects for somewhat high IQs, probably more so at Duke than wherever you were in Quebec, and selects for conformity. And so you now conclude that high IQ people are more conformist. If you just sort of reasoned that out before you said it, you might see a problem with, you know, referencing your personal experience there.
I don't remember seeing any study about this, but IQ correlation between IQ and parallel processing. So in 1993, see, it's not so hard to search for science, because I didn't know at all about it. I just Googled it, and here we have an article. Let's see what they have to say. Reaction times for the detection of straight and slanted lines in the presence of slanted and straight line distractors were related to IQ. Correlations between IQ and detection of straight lines, a serial processing task, did not differ from correlations between IQ and detection of slanted lines, a parallel processing task. Variability of reaction times was inversely related to IQ. Oh. So higher IQ people taking their time. Interesting. The data provides support for the worst performance rule. Correlations between reaction times and IQ became increasingly negative as the percentile rank of the reaction times increased. So essentially, this article would the answer to your question would be yes, to a certain extent. Higher IQ people correlates with higher ability to process parallelly. That being said, it may be through a reaction time effect. That is, it may be a case where IQ correlates with a self-control measure of some kind, whereby the person has a tendency to take his time more to accomplish the task properly. Very interesting.
That's not what that means, JF. Higher IQ people were quicker than the lower IQ people. This simply means that among the higher IQ people, there was less variation, meaning their reaction times were more clustered together. And this is sort of a rule with elite performance in general, is that the margins are thinner. For example, if you took an Olympic 400 meter race, the runners are going to be bunched up with each other. Whereas if you take high school kids and have them run 400 meters, they'll all be spread out by the end. There'll be far more variation in the times than you will have at the elite level. And the negative correlation between reaction time and IQ means that lower IQ people have higher reaction times, which means they're reacting slower. Higher IQ people have less reaction time, since reaction time is negatively correlated with IQ, which means the higher IQ people are reacting faster. I mean, getting this mixed up isn't a huge deal, because the way it's worded is a little bit confusing, and it's not typically how people talk about this sort of stuff. They'll typically describe a correlation between some ability and speed, because speed is the thing you want. So this is worded in a somewhat confusing way, but I'm just saying, while I'm at it and while I'm making a video about all the other foibles of JF, I might as well say that JF got this wrong too. But more troubling is that he didn't seem to know what variance meant, at least here. Maybe it's just a little brain fart, but that's more troubling.
Okay, strong claim. Now, what does he illustrate this with? He says, so these are all theoretical. All right, so what does this figure mean? Taleb has been generating a model here. That's fictive data, and that's actual data. So Taleb has generated a model just to make his point that a measure that actually does not measure intelligence in the high ability range, that is, people with 100 IQ or more, so anyone above the mean, you can think of a measure that only measures mental issues or mental delays, yet this measure will correlate as if it was indicative of intelligence. And he demonstrates this by, look, I'm going to make a model. This is a measure that only predicts your actual performance in the negative sphere, that is, in those low ability people. So the measure is good to show how retarded you are, but as soon as you reach the average, it evaluates everyone equally. In other words, this measure is informative for the handicapped or the learning disabilities, but it is not informative for genius or for even any sort of positive ability with respect to the mean. Now he says, let me add noise to this. He adds noise. And you end up with this. Now, this is still correlating positively. In fact, all of these measures, they all give correlations, but they violate the statistical assumptions such that making a linear correlation out of these statistics is lying to yourself to some extent.
This is nice, but it's kind of an I'm rubber, you're glue argument. Sure, if you add noise to any relationship, you obscure the nature of the relationship. The relationship could in reality be stronger at the higher end between two variables. And if you add noise, you would obscure that relationship just as much as you would obscure the relationship Taleb thinks exists. I don't know why you're pretending so hard not to understand this. Taleb on this SAT thing is just describing skill gap compression, and he's a stat denier who hates stat shaming. That's all this is. Of course, we've already established that this kind of relationship is not always the case. Sometimes the relationship is stronger on the lower end, but sometimes it's stronger on the higher end, as in the case with patents, or as in the case with income in Denmark, it's linear, or in this sample of ACT test takers, there's a banana curved in the other direction between on the relationship between IQ and ACT scores. And there's even some SAT samples using Raven's progressive matrices data that shows more predictive power on the higher end, although I would say it's more linear than that. But like what Taleb is saying here is true, which is a quantum leap forward from his other word salad, but it's trivial. All he's showing is that a noisy relationship can make it difficult to tell what's going on. But then when he says, this is what's going on, that IQ is not predicting outcomes at the higher end of the spectrum, well, that statement is just simply false.
And so we have a fictive scenario in which indeed we have fooled the mathematics of linear correlation to believe that there was a linear correlation when there is none. And we've done this by making sure that we had a model that expresses zero information on high IQ people. And in fact, by high IQ, I mean anything above the average. Yet by adding noise, we just blur it so that people don't necessarily realize. But what we have is a measure that seals at some point in the distribution, such that it is just a measure of disability. Now, Nassim shows us the actual data of IQ, and he says, this is exactly like my model. I mean, it has the same shape. The SAT scores of people are well predicted in the mental disability part of the distribution, that is, people with 70 IQ. Of course, they score bad on SAT scores. But as soon as you reach average intelligence, 100, you have a relatively flat distribution, just like you would have here. And in fact, it's amazing because these kind of correlations between 0.45 and 0.78 is the kind of correlation we regularly get from these studies linking scholar accomplishment to IQ. Therefore, Nassim demonstrates that a measure that is solely a negative measure of disability can be mistaken by the current mathematics use in linear correlations as a measure of intelligence. Beautiful. That is a strong point.
So when watching JF's video, this really made me do a double take. Taleb attacks IQ for violating what he says are the standards of monotonicity. Now, Taleb is being dishonest here because he's obviously trying to make the audience think that monotonicity and transitivity are generally recognized requirements among statisticians and scientists in general. But they're not. This is literally just made up. And as you will see, abiding by Taleb's standards will turn you into a drooling retard who can't say anything meaningful about the world. And monotonicity is just an obscure way of saying linear. It just means an increase of one standard deviation on the y-axis will result in an increase in one standard deviation on the x-axis and vice versa, making something that looks like this, a linear relationship. So here's a relationship between IQ and income in Denmark, almost perfectly linear. However, because the relationship between IQ and SAT scores is more like this, this means IQ is not a measurement or something. I don't know. It's Taleb. Now, while Taleb and JF think that nonlinearity of relationships is some sort of problem, the way nonlinear data is actually handled by people who know what they're doing and talking about is either with a log transformation or a log regression. Or you can also do a sinusoidal or exponential power regression. I mean, you could probably model how much fertilizer to put in soil in this way, with too much fertilizer having diminishing returns or even causing negative results. And the fact that this relationship is nonlinear does not mean that the amount of fertilizer you put in the soil is not a measure or is in some other way invalid. Now, JF is a bit smarter than Taleb. He never said that IQ wasn't a measure. Of course, anyone who's not stupid knows that the fact that this relationship between fertilizer and soil productivity isn't linear doesn't mean that the data is wrong or that it's some great failing of measuring the amount of fertilizer or something. Same with the relationship between IQ and SAT. At a certain threshold for SAT scores, within this sample at least, variation in IQ didn't matter. That's not a failure of IQ. That's just the reality of the relationship between IQ and SAT scores. In fact, why don't we say that SAT fails? Because at the higher levels, increases in SAT scores don't correspond to increases in IQ. Wow, SAT is a failed measure because it fails to predict IQ at the higher end. This objection is totally made up. Now here's a paper looking at the relationship between IQ and ACT scores, and they find a different relationship. It's a banana, but it's curved in the other way. I'm a bit puzzled at this lack of understanding, not by Taleb. Taleb's dumb as pig shit. What I'm puzzled by is JF, who almost certainly must have seen and worked with hundreds of nonlinear relationships in his field, right? Did he just throw out any relationship that wasn't linear? Or maybe it's a language thing where JF doesn't know what monotonic means and so just kind of pretends he does and goes along with Taleb? But then when Taleb is showing why a lack of monotonicity is a problem and shows a chart with a not perfectly linear correlation, well, even if JF didn't know what monotonicity meant beforehand, by that point, JF should have known that monotonicity just meant linearity and realized Taleb was full of shit. And by full of shit, Taleb is that to a degree that I can't properly verbalize. I can't verbalize how dumb Taleb is here. I guess I'll just say he is several times dumber than Kraut, than anything Kraut did. I mean, it is a deep and profound level of stupidity what Taleb is saying here. People who don't have any understanding of statistics, don't have any understanding of what any of these terms means, can look at a chart like this or look at a graph like this, and they can have an intuitive understanding of the relationship between IQ and SAT scores and can understand that it's meaningful down here, but once you get to higher scores, IQ, higher SAT scores, IQ doesn't matter. Like a 100 IQ person can look at that and understand that. Taleb cannot. Another problem that Taleb kept prattling on about was fat tails, fat tails. And again, this is just more obscure language. It's an obscure way of saying something that has a commonly accepted term. And that commonly accepted term is non-normal distribution. All fat tails means is that the data isn't normally distributed. Normal distribution just means that the data on something looks like this, the bell curve. I don't remember the ratios offhand, but you can easily look up what the percentages are for the various standard deviation in a normal distribution is. For example, height in a population may have a peak, which is just a point that is both the median and mode, and on either side are an equal number of values, which are equivalent values from this peak in the normal distribution, meaning that there are just as many people 1 foot taller as there are 1 foot shorter from the midpoint. And whatever the standard deviation is on either side, that's how you sort of classify the standard deviations, which may be, the standard deviations may be 1.137 feet, something like that. Now, in the real world, this is almost never 100% true. Almost nothing is ever totally, perfectly normally distributed. But it's usually true enough due to something known as the central limit theorem. which I'm not going to go into here, but it's just a fact of reality that data tends towards normal distributions, though never perfectly. So when running a correlation, it's best practice to check for normality, because a Pearson's correlation assumes a population with a perfectly normal distribution. And if you have a sample with values that look like this, a Pearson's correlation still assumes the real data looks like this, which is usually not even a big deal, except when it is a big deal. And in those instances, you use what are known as non-parametric statistics, which are correlations that don't assume normality. They are rank order correlations, which simply means you look at the relation between the rank order on the x-axis to the rank order on the y-axis. The rank order between one variable and the rank order between another variable. Again, this is not very complicated. This is stuff that JF should know. However, and I want to point out that even if data in the real world looks like this, which it rarely does, but even if it does, the relationship can still be linear to some degree, and a Pearson's correlation that assumes normality can still yield predictively valid results. In fact, it's possible for a Pearson's correlation to produce a more predictively valid result than a Spearman or Kendall correlation, even if the actual population being observed is radically abnormal. So what does any of this have to do with IQ in particular? Nothing. Nothing. Taleb and sadly, apparently JF, are making arguments against basic statistical methods. And not particularly high-level arguments, but really basic errors that I know are garbage based on that one semester of statistics I took in college. That's a lie, I took a little bit more, but I'm not a statistician. This is really basic stuff, and anyone should be ashamed and embarrassed for making these kinds of arguments, but especially JF, who struts around as some sort of intellectual and speaks authoritatively and attacks psychologists for not understanding statistics.
Different populations have different variances. Even different skewness and these comparisons require richer models. I agree. I don't like the talk. You'll never hear me talk in standard deviations. First, because who cares about this technical language? If they're lower, just say lower. And second, because the technical language actually relies on assumptions that we don't know are true. What if the fat tails of the black people are different from the fat tails of the white people? You just don't know. Different populations have different variances, okay? These are severe, severe mathematical flaws. A billion papers in psychometrics wouldn't count if you have such a flaw. See the formal treatment in my next book. He is largely correct. Those are severe mathematical flaws.
The reason we use standard deviations is because that is a way of describing placement within a normal distribution. You can also use a percentile distribution. Sure, you can say higher or lower, but saying this or that many standard deviations lower gives more information than saying higher or lower, and it functions as a kind of universal magnitude. Any criteria can have percentile rank or standard deviation distances from the mean. Height, weight, running speed, anything that can be measured. This allows us to compare apples and oranges because we can look at the change in one standard deviation on the apple and how much change that is associated with the orange measured in standard deviations for the orange. Now, the standard deviation of the orange can be different from the standard deviation from the apple, but that doesn't matter because we're comparing standard deviations, which allows us to speak on both scales. Now, most things in reality do tend towards normality, central limit theorem, but if they deviate from normality to such a degree that it becomes a problem, then we can just go to percentiles. As for different populations having different standard deviations, the way this is dealt with is by either creating pooled standard deviations or just using the standard deviation of one of the populations. I guess in Taleb's cryptic sort of way, what he's pointing out is that human populations are multimodal, which is fine, but all data is inherently multimodal, so I don't know what exactly his point is here. Yes, every population on the planet is going to have differences not just in the peak of their distributions, but also in the tightness of their distributions. So what? I don't get what this is supposed to be an argument against. If this is supposed to be an argument against IQ, well, that's fine, but then is Taleb a radical skeptic of statistics in general? Because this can be applied to virtually anything. Now, what JF says, speaking in standard deviations assumes normality, which may not be true. Sure, any assumption may not be true if you just assume it without checking. But lucky for us, IQ scores are in fact very much normally distributed. So don't you worry, JF. That criticism doesn't apply to IQ.
Now, he says it doesn't satisfy the monotonicity and transitivity required to have a measure. So monotonic and transitivity, of course, you can argue that they are not needed for a measure to exist, for a number to exist. You can just argue that it's just an imperfect measure, and therefore it's imperfectly transitive. What does it mean, transitive? It means if I have a 99 IQ person, that person will always be more intelligent than a 98 IQ person, and the 98 will always be more intelligent than the 97, and there are no world in which the 97 being less intelligent than the 98 would at the same time be more intelligent than the 99. Now, it's a tough thing in a noisy measure to affirm transitivity or not is a tough call to make.
No, this is not what transitivity means. Transitivity means that if there's a relationship with A and B, a relationship with B and C, then there will be a relationship with A and C as a result of the two other relationships. The relationship is transitive between the three variables. Or it could be transitive to four variables, five variables, but we're just looking at three here. The way you're defining transitivity, JF, is what you're actually describing is perfect linearity between two variables. IQ and intelligence, for example, with someone with one higher IQ point must always have more quote unquote true intelligence than someone with one lower IQ point in order to be transitive. Basically, you're defining transitivity as perfect linearity of a relationship. And obviously, that, the perfect linearity of a relationship, that's not any kind of requirement or standard in a statistical relationship. But on top of this, actual transitivity, as I correctly described it, is not necessary for IQ to be a measure or to use relationships with IQ, nor is it any kind of quality standard for a relationship.
It is a false comparison to claim that IQ measures the hardware rather than the software. It can measure some arbitrary selected mental abilities in a testing environment believed to be useful. However, if you take a Popperian Hayekian view on intelligence, you would realize that to measure it, you would need to know the mental skills needed in a future ecology, which requires predictability of said future ecology. It also requires the skill to make it to the future, hence the need for mental biases for survival. Beautifully said. That is true.
Okay, a future ecology just means the world that you're in. Having an IQ of something in 2000, does that correlate with life outcomes in 2010? That's all this is about. A future ecology just means a future world, stuff that you're dealing with. And yes, it does. This is stupid. The validity of IQ over time is well established. It's so well established, in fact, that we can use studies from the 1970s and studies from the 2010s interchangeably, and it operationally doesn't matter because they all show the same relationships between outcomes and IQ. Shut the fuck up, Taleb. You don't know what you're talking about. And whatever he's babbling about, Hayekian Popperian view of truth, right, whatever that is, it's bullshit. I don't know what it is. I don't know what Hayekian Popperian is. But if Taleb's citing it, it's probably just bullshit flat out. Or at most, it's being applied in a bullshit way. So at most, Hayekian Popperian whatever could be something. But since Taleb has never properly applied a true statement, we have to assume Taleb is improperly applying it here. Most of the time, Taleb's statements are either outright false or not even truth apt, so I'm gonna guess that Hayekian, Popperian, whatever is like philosophy kid stuff, okay? And that's what Taleb is. He's like a 110 IQ guy who read a little bit of philosophy and like a little bit of statistics, and he knows just enough to make a mess, and he knows just enough to be kind of confused by more complicated things that are actually solved by people who are further advanced in their fields, but he just doesn't understand like what non-parametric statistics are and stuff like that. So he thinks it's like really profound, but no, we actually have very simple answers to this very common problem that Taleb thinks is some sort of fucking revelation. And so Taleb gets on the internet, he makes a big fucking mess here. I recognize it as a mess, but JF thinks it's art or something. But on to the point here, you don't need any kind of comprehensive understanding of a future world in order to make specific predictions about it. And to a certain degree, nobody can know absolutely everything about a future world, and we can't know about even 2 or 3 days into the future except in very broad generalities. When meteorologists make weather predictions, they predict things like chance of rain, percentage cloud cover, or broad classes of cloud formations. They won't be able to tell you specifically what the clouds will look like at any moment in time. And we don't expect that kind of granular knowledge from meteorologists if they can make meaningful predictions. So when Taleb demands IQ researchers know about a future ecology, well, to what degree is he talking about? Do we have to know the position of every single atom in the universe? This is a very vague kind of requirement. Taleb also talks about paper trading. Well, that's a very cute line, but IQ tests have been around long enough that this isn't theory anymore. This isn't paper trading anymore. Maybe in the 1920s, the predictive power was somewhat theoretical, but certainly by the 1940s, that attack had been rebutted with real-world results, which have just continued to pile up for the next 80 years. This is probably the worst attack angle you could make on IQ, since IQ is probably the most real-world results-validated construct in all of the social sciences.
I don't share Nassim's goals. However, I share his dislike of IQ, which is a unidimensional measure for something that is much more complex. It must be complex. Intelligence must be complex because forms of intelligence show up in various situations in the world. You can be intelligent in a way that leads you to high social skills, so you can escalate ladders in a company, or you can be intelligent in the way of Albert Einstein, be creative. You can be intelligent in the field of mathematics. You can be intelligent in the market, in finding what people want and dealing properly. All of these things, they are all different performances. To think that we can collide all of the complex realizations of humanity into a single continuous and transitive measure, a unidimensional number, is ridiculous to start with. The G-factor is this theoretical entity created by intellectuals who support IQ tests. And it's kind of this theoretical thing that is never, you can never really reach it, but it is the claim that within whatever we measure, whatever we use as an IQ test, it is the claim that there is some common factor, some unidimensional variable that measures cognitive performance across all these tests, but not in the same way. The test may touch G partially, if you will. G factor is like the god of IQ researchers. It's this thing, but you cannot really question it. It has to be there. You kind of have to assume that it's there to extract it. It's kind of saying, well, none of the IQ tests are perfect, but they all contain the output of a perfect measure, the G, the god of IQ research.
Okay, so JF says that G is taken as an article of faith by IQ researchers. No, it's not. It's more like inferring the existence of a neutron star based on its gravitational effects. Sure, we can't directly observe, just as we can't directly observe intelligence or even creativity or any such thing. But that doesn't stop JF from saying creativity is a real thing that exists. Unlike the nebulous concept of creativity, the general intelligence factor is something that can be quantified and shown to predict a person's performance on other tasks. And this was something that was found by our buddy, Charles Spearman, who invented the Spearman correlation that we talked about. He found that your performance on one subject predicts your performance on another subject. But beyond that, some subjects predicted performance on other school subjects better than others. And he was able to do something called principal component analysis creating a factor called the G factor. And this G factor predicted the majority of variance on everything. Later, he did this with IQ tests, and lo and behold, he found the same thing. Principal component analysis found that the majority of covariance in IQ tests were accounted for by a single factor, which we call the G factor, the general intelligence factor. So this is much as true. This is not a thing we're debating. G as a statistical reality is not debated at all. It is proven beyond a shadow of a doubt. Now, as for genetic G, there's really not even a whole lot of room for debate that, but I'll just say this. For genetic G, there's like maybe a 1% window of debate. For statistical G, there's literally no window. So there are debates about why statistical G is and why this construct is so powerful. Why is one's ability to do crosswords related to one's ability to repair bicycles? Why is literally every cognitive task, sometimes to a high degree and sometimes to a minute degree, related to every other possible thing you can do? Another thing to consider is that G is more heritable than non-G subtests. Now, I remember a long time ago when Jeff Holliday made a video attacking IQ and he was describing G, he just kind of blurted out that G was not only a principal component, but that it was the genetic component to IQ. Now, the funny thing about that is that wasn't in the textbook that Jeff Holliday was reading, but Holliday intuitively understood this. Even when he wasn't told, he intuitively understood that G stands for general, but general kind of means genetic. Now, I know Holliday didn't know about the twin study showing the positive correlation between G loading of a test and its heritability, and that technically he had no more reason to presume genetic G was a thing, but I think it's just a little example of a naive, and by naive I mean no prior baggage on this issue, how a naive student just intuitively comes to the most obvious and parsimonious conclusion about what G is. Because when we look at how G behaves, and that it's the most heritable component of an already 80% heritable IQ test, what other conclusion can you honestly come to? What's the most parsimonious explanation for this? And the more G-loaded a test is, the less malleable it is as well. Yes, in theory, you shouldn't assume that heritability equals malleability. In practice, there's a strong relation. In addition, people with low nominal IQs, but who score well on the most G-loaded subtests, that is those subtests that are good at predicting your ability on other tests, they have a much easier time raising their overall IQ scores. Now, JF sounded pretty confident proclaiming the falsity of G. Well, by all means, JF, explain it. Yes, we as humans like to divide cognitive abilities into neat little categories like science and math and spelling and spatial reasoning, but that doesn't mean the brain is going to be compartmentalized in that way in any physiological sense. And if you want to say G is just a construct, well, so is the idea of intelligence being topic specific. If you think mathematical ability is a real thing, okay, well, can you stick a syringe into someone's brain and show me how many milliliters of mathematical ability is in there? No, you infer mathematical ability from performance, just as you infer the mass of a neutron star from its gravitational effects on surrounding objects. But unlike a neutron star, mathematical ability isn't even a specific thing. In the brain, it's just neurons doing neuron stuff. And so when you shit on me for reifying the construct of G, well, how is that any different from reifying the construct of math ability? You can point to what is called a math test and say it's a test for math, this math thing that you presume is distinct and independent from other forms of intelligence. Well, you don't know a priori that it's any more a test for math than it is for the general intelligence factor, or than it is for Bob's cool tapes factor. Now, if you want to point to data showing the compartmentalization of ability and how math performance is to some degree independent of various other tests, well, now what you're doing is you're making the exact same kinds of arguments I use to point to the generalization of all functions that implies an underlying general intelligence factor. You're making those same kind of arguments just in the opposite direction. Instead of trying to reify a general intelligence factor, you're trying to reify specific intelligence factors. this attack on G and this attack on reification of G is blatantly hypocritical. All forms of intelligence are constructs. They're all notions. And the G factor is no more or less objectively real than math ability or spatial reasoning ability or any other specific factor that you want to construct. On IQ tests, there are subtests. There's verbal, there's spatial, there's math, coding, patterns. That's what they're called. But don't be so presumptuous as to think that you know that the math test only tests the math part of the brain. Maybe it does, maybe it doesn't. Maybe all of these tests are just testing the brain as a holistic entity. Or maybe it's a mixture of both, specific and G factor. Okay, spoiler, it's a mixture of both. G and both non-G exist, the general intelligence factor being more a function of genetics than non-G is. Non-G being easier to improve. The better you do on the more G-loaded factors of an IQ test, the easier it is to improve your performance on the less G-loaded factors. And a way to visualize it is as kind of a base and superstructure. G is the base, non-GIQ is the superstructure. Other terms that are used are crystallized and fluid intelligence. And this is something I've said several times. At root, IQ researchers don't actually care about IQ. They care about G. And what a knowledge of G allows you to do is infer the G of any population based on any test. Now, the more G-loaded the test, the better your estimate will be. But all tests are to some degree or another G-loaded. And so all these like international tests or various national level tests, they can all be used to form a G estimate all over the world. And this gives you an entirely new dimension to understand the world. And by seeing in this dimension, you end up realizing that the policies that will work in Burma or Cambodia won't work in Black Africa. Heck, what will work in Egypt won't work in Sudan because there's something like a 1.5 standard deviation difference in G between Egyptians and Nubians, even though the nominal IQ difference may be only 2/3 of a standard deviation. It also prevents you from going down blind alleys. In 1950, China was poorer than Black Africa, which makes sense as Black Africa was being administered by the British, but now China is rising up towards the level of Japan. When the lid of feudalism and then the lid of communism was lifted, the natural, I guess sort of like the buoyancy shot straight up and is doing so now until it'll get to the point of diminishing returns and growth will slow. China hasn't reached the point where it stabilizes relative to the rest of the world, nor has India. India is going to stabilize at something like Brazil in terms of living standards, and China's going to stabilize, you know, about wherever Japan is. Africa? Well, I wouldn't say for sure that I know that Africa has reached its relative stabilization point, but it may have. And any attempt to push policy that made China rich are just not going to have the same results in Africa because the differences in this G thing. And I'm going to have to add this here. Apparently in one of JF's papers, they use principal component analysis for something. I must admit, I don't exactly understand what's going on in this paper and I couldn't be arsed to read it through properly. Principal component analysis is simply a way of inferring and measuring the effects of a latent variable that you can't directly measure. Now, in JF's paper, they were looking at some sort of brain patterns for monkeys in response to certain stimuli. And one section of this paper says, quote, to test whether different neuronal frames of reference, self, other, and both referenced, were anatomically segregated, we used principal component analysis on recording coordinates to identify the major axis with the largest dispersion within three-dimensional space, close quote. Now, I'm just going to say this. Whatever principal component you're deriving, JF, whatever your sample is, whatever your p-value is, whatever your power is, the G factor beats whatever it is you did here in 2013 on any objective statistical criteria. Now, this was 6 years ago. Maybe you've changed your mind about principal component analysis, but in the past, you used the same methods that psychometricians were using to derive the G factor, except everything was just weaker in what you did. And before you try, JF, no, I'm not commenting, quote unquote, about your paper. We're not having a discussion about your paper. Don't try to hook me into some general discussion about your bogus monkey brain research. I'm commenting about your use of principal component analysis in 2013 and accepting much weaker statistical evidence from that than what exists for the G factor using the same method. JF also tells us how IQ doesn't tell us about creativity. Well, if by creativity we mean actually creates meaningful things, well then you're probably wrong, JF. From this paper, The Social Origins and IQ of Inventors, which as far as I can tell isn't published in a journal but is just original research by these four guys, they found that IQ is super duper pooper strongly related with the likelihood of inventing something that will receive a patent. Now, you can define creativity in a subjective way, and you can say that this or that art is creative, which is like, that's just like your opinion, man. And in that case, we're not really having a scientific discussion. But who knows what JF actually means by creativity here? If we mean creates things that are then granted a patent, then no, inventors appear to have very high IQs. And as a bonus, this relationship gets stronger the higher up in the arc you get. So it's not al negativa or whatever. It's IQ predicting high level ability, not merely a lack of dysfunction at the lower levels. All right, so this is the end here where I wax poetic a bit. What are we looking at? What's going on? JF's arguments here are not good. They are uncharacteristically bad for JF. JF is not acting like himself on IQ. And he is making these really bad arguments after he interacted more with white nationalists. In particular, Richard Spencer. So maybe he's going after IQ because of some deal he made with Richard Spencer or some strategy session with Richard Spencer where they thought that would be a good idea. But first off, probably not, because those things just straight up are pretty rare. But on top of that, if JF was intentionally saying false things about IQ for some reason that we can't exactly pin down, he wouldn't spurg out about my little animation I posted on my other channel about this video. He would just try to ignore me because he would know his arguments were weak. But JF is not ignoring, which implies that JF is making these arguments in good faith. He thinks these are good arguments. But then that opens another question. How the hell does someone with the professional background JF has make the kinds of arguments he has? Now, you could ask the same question about Taleb, but that ship has sailed long ago. It's just the way of the Nassim. He likes to say things and is confused by simple concepts, and he misinterprets his confusion and ignorance for having stumbled upon some new problems in the field. No, Nassim, you didn't find some new problems. You're just so stupid and you're so behind the curve that you don't know what's going on. But on top of that, you lack the theory of mind to consider that there may be some other people who do know what's going on. But then for whatever god-awful reason, you have a platform and you can propound on your ignorance as insight and convince a whole bunch of people who don't know anything that your ignorance is insight. But that's just Nassim. JF, based on my interaction, seemed to be able to understand things when I talked to him about it. People are saying that JF has declined. Okay, well, it's one thing to be a bit looser with your statements as you become more distant from academia and become more comfortable with the standards of internet streaming. Not that that's even necessarily a bad thing, right? The standards for academia may be stifling to a point of preventing the exploration of ideas. There are costs and benefits to having tight or loose standards of evidence. But it's one thing to sort of loosen up intellectually. It's another to say what JF has said in his video, a kind of fundamental detachment from evidence, and I guess JF just forgot a lot of what he learned about regressions. I guess maybe it's kind of a use it or lose it situation, but there's no need to relitigate all that I've said previously. All that I've said previously is in this video, so I don't have to recap. So I keep thinking about this, and my mind keeps meandering on this, as if thinking about it for long enough will generate some sort of explanation for why JF is being uncharacteristically incompetent when it comes to IQ. But of course it won't. I have no answer for it, and all I can do is convey to you, the viewer, how bizarre all this is. Now, I guess at the end, I mean, where else would I say this stuff? I want to wrap up a few loose ends here. So first, JF brought up a DM conversation that we had. Now, JF, not a smart thing to do, to bring up DM convos. Okay, I'm not going to do the whole screenshot and going through convos. Let's not go there. But I just do want to respond to what you said. What I was saying about the woman you are with was that you have undue influence over, right? You can look up the concept of undue influence. and that seems wrong from a relationship kind of stand. What I said had nothing to do with her attractiveness or anything. Now, and this, another loose end, to the viewers who think I should do a live debate with JF, here's a little illustration as to why that's stupid. Say JF and I are talking about IQ and conformity, and JF brings up his personal experience on that, with high IQ people at the universities he went to being conformist and non-explanatory and dull and closed-minded or whatever. Well, okay. In a live setting, would I be able to assemble the studies that I had and remember the contents of a bunch of studies showing that what JF says isn't true? No, because there's no time in a live setting to do any of it. Live exchanges are going to be inherently low information and low depth of argument. And sort of my gimmick is the opposite of that. My gimmick is the studies and presenting the studies and the tables and the charts and being able to just show that people are wrong in a straightforward way because facts, right? And you can't do that in a live setting. Imagine if instead of that doing that India video that I did, I instead chose to live debate. I live debated someone pushing the India oppression narrative. Say they claim that the British destroyed the Indian textile industry and then shipped the cotton produced in India to Britain and then forced Indians to buy British textiles. Let's say they're making that argument. Now you, the viewer, you have 5 seconds to respond to that. Answer now. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Stumped. You sat there for 5 seconds, a little more, I gave you a little bit more time. You sat there for 5 seconds thinking about the question. That means you're stumped. That means you can't answer it. That's what live debates are like. You can't, how do you respond to all of these empirical claims? Like they're making all these claims about facts, about trade figures and stuff. How are you supposed to deal with that in a live setting? Now, if you're someone like Richard Spencer, yeah, you can deal with that in a live setting by just going, Faustian, Fausti Faust, Evola, might makes right, spirit will, you know, you can just babble a bunch of that crap and justify the British conquest of India and not argue against the claims and not argue against the fundamental oppression narrative. Right? So sure, I mean, if your worldview is very simple and kind of stupid and low information, that yeah, you can do fine in a live setting. But if you're actually going to challenge claims that are made, you need time. You gotta go look stuff up. And you gotta go look stuff up that's not readily processed and available in articles written like you know, I'm writing the first articles on this stuff, you know, the stuff about India, you know. Now the primary research was done. I didn't do that, obviously, but I'm sort of doing the first collation of it, you know. I'm not going to other books or other articles that are friendly for public consumption. No, I'm going into the primary research, right, and collating that into something that is understandable to the average person, right? You can't do that in a live debate, buddy. So you saw just how long this video was, for example. You saw just how much I had to say in this response to JF. Now imagine trying to say all of this in a setting where JF is interrupting me all along the way, possibly muting me, demanding that I answer his questions. And he's interrupting me and saying, don't talk about that. Answer this thing that I brought up. You got to answer this thing I brought up, you know. And so I can't even make my case because JF is demanding that I answer whatever questions he's asking. And then on top of that, you have random interruptions by, you know,
Wotan Wolf 88, Day of the Rope Win,
you know, dumb super chats coming in and interrupting. You get nowhere. Now, in terms of effect, the big effect of live debates seems to be to damage people. Now, very rarely does a live debate in isolation completely destroy someone. It didn't completely destroy Mundane Matt, for example. Now, a lot was revealed in a single live appearance with Mundane Matt that destroyed him. But it was based on preceding events, and that stream just lifted the lid on it. Tonka was not destroyed by live debates. He was, in fact, you know, his bluster in sort of a live setting may have actually helped him a little bit. but he was destroyed by events that had nothing to do with his live debate performances. Ian Miles Chong is being destroyed. It has nothing to do with anything done, anything said in like a live debate setting. Right? It's all these are individuals. Now, this is sort of a character assassination thing. Now, you could say well-deserved character assassinations, but the live debate itself is not actually destroying them. And even let's take sort of the best case, you know, Richard Spencer, you know, in the quote unquote debate with Sargon. What did we get from that? Well, we got this cute meme: Sargon, you're not as smart as you think you are, and it's kind of a funny meme, and it kind of took the piss out of Sargon. But I mean, that was what, like where's Sargon now? Where's Richard Spencer now? Sargon did a bunch of other dumb shit that had much more profound effect than that debate, right? That, you know, that BBC interview, which then morphed into the hit piece on him and getting the Patreon taken down and the stuff that Jim did on Sargon, that had a much more profound effect than that live debate in terms of the negative effects. But even then, even after all that, Sargon is still light years ahead of where Richard Spencer is. Okay, so even after not just the Richard Spencer debate, but after all the other damage that's been done to Sargon, Sargon's still trucking along, and Sargon is still far more prominent and far more influential than Richard Spencer. Okay, and that's sort of like the best case scenario. Like, so what then do live debates really even do? On top of this mania for live debates, or this desire for live debates, I shouldn't call it a mania, it's largely irrelevant because our enemies just aren't going to debate. I mean, you get some sort of low-rent scum like, you know, Bronx Blogger, or you'll get a guy like Kevin Logan who there are reasons that he's a little bit different. And so, but you're not going to, like, you're not going to get ContraPoints on there. You're not going to get H Bomber Guy on there. You know, and if you do, maybe you'll have it like one time. But like, the thing is, you're not going to have live debates going on enough for being good at them to really benefit you. You know, because look at it from their perspective. Why would they roll the dice by going into sort of the chaos of a live setting when they can just use their media monopolies and use sort of their, you know, YouTube algorithm favoring them and promoting their channels? You know, they can use that to just keep grinding you down. They don't need to go into, they're not going to live debate. Why would they trade a sure thing for a 50-50? That's what they're sort of doing with the live debate. And in terms of advancing ideas, you know, live debates don't advance any ideas. You know, and they're not going to advance the ideas unless you have ideas on two sides. You're not going to get a good presentation of the ideas from both sides in a live settings because it's extemporaneous, it's constantly being interrupted, the sources you don't have on hand, the arguments that you present for any subposition within your constellation of positions is going to be whatever it is you can remember at that moment. You know, the arguments that you make could be affected by, you know, how tired you are, could be affected by how stressed you are at the moment, could be affected by what you were just previously talking about, right? It's a mess. It's an absolute mess. And you can say it's a form of entertainment. Well, fine. You know, you can, I'm not going to judge what it is you're entertained by. But it's not a way to flesh out ideas. And you could say, well, and I guess some people might say, well, it's a kind of a toughness or confront or something, your confrontability. It's a kind of a talk fighting. I mean, I see all these, you know, it's something like all these people who sort of do a confrontational talk fighting, you know, these are oftentimes not people who can actually confront in like a real, in a real world confrontation setting, right? Where you know, you go in and you say, okay, here's this guy's account. I'm gonna straight up destroy this guy's account, or I'm going to, you know, actually physically fight this person. I don't think there's a whole lot of relevance to that at all. In fact, I think it's kind of the opposite, that the people who have the big mouths are, well, I won't go into that. But also, it's a stupid thing to be interested in. Who's got the best confront? Who can confront other people effectively? And I don't think that that being able to win the live debate has much to do with either sort of a personal toughness or confronting in the way confrontations occur in the real world, even if that's even what you care about. Although that's a kind of a tangent, it's kind of irrelevant, you know. So in terms of advancing ideas, like, the radio talk shows can advance ideas in a very slow way, but they're not. But the thing is, they're not even advancing them in a confrontational setting. Like the Right Stuff Radio, TDS, they're not constantly getting people on arguing with them all the time, right? Because you can't build a house when there's another guy there trying to tear down the house. You know, every time you try to put up a beam, there's a guy there trying to rip it out. You can't do that. You can't build anything there. And it's just pointless. Very little is settled with the live debate. Now, one thing people can say is, well, sour grapes. You know, you're not particularly good at live debates. Well, I'm not particularly bad at them either, you know. But the thing is, everybody is better when they have more time to prepare. But with me, that gap between unprepared and prepared is way bigger than it is for most people. And it just comes down to the fact that I do so much more research than other people. And that has always been what sort of separated me, not from everyone. There's people who do more research than me, right? But that's just sort of what separates me from most people, is just my willingness to just read lots and lots of stuff. And in a live setting, that advantage or that distinction is negated. So, you know, so trying to push me into a live setting is just let's negate every advantage Ryan has into this really low info, low latency form of interaction. Okay, the next thing is I'm noticing a rise of anti-IQ people in general. And everyone has their own reason for opposing IQ. Some of them may think it's bullshit, or they may read my articles and think I'm not explaining it enough, that I'm not rigorous enough. And for those people, go read the source material or go read the more technical treatments on the matter yourself. There's plenty of people who go into far more depth than me on this. So if you're saying, oh, I think IQ is bullshit because Ryan Falk is not particularly technical about it or not technical enough for me about it, you're being dishonest. Because if you found me, you could find it. You would have found it if you wanted to find it. You would have found Human Varieties. You would have found, you know, Gene Expressions. You would have found even people like, well, you would have found the HBD sphere, okay, if you wanted a more technical treatment. Now, from an activist standpoint, someone can still be very relevant by documenting just how extreme anti-white institutional racism is, that stuff is valuable, without necessarily being a big collector or analyzer of statistics. But if you're trying to be an intellectual and you're data phobic, you don't like stats, well, you're shit out of luck, and you should be mocked for the attempt, right? Because if you don't have the stats, you're not an intellectual, get out. And there's a big red flag for these kinds of people, and that flag is Evola. Another one would be Nietzsche, is a little less of a flag, Faust. Just a fascist philosopher. And anyone who's into Evola or some fascist philosopher is an idiot. For the anti-IQ people, like, what's your line breaker? You can't just spin narrative. You can't just tell a story. You can't just seduce, okay? Because you spin a narrative, all right, well, they spin a narrative too. They spin their narrative, you spin your narrative, the lines don't move, okay? There's this oppression narrative. It's about slavery, segregation, colonialism, white privilege. And you gotta go after that narrative. Why? Because this narrative is used to justify the anti-white racism. That's it. Those are the two things you need, and they reinforce each other. You need documentation of anti-white racism and also, you know, documentation of anti-first world racism, for example, laws against the Chinese in Malaysia. And you need to break down all the ideology that upholds the institutional racism. That's the what I call the oppression narrative. Because if you don't explain to normies the systemic anti-white racism, they won't understand why you're attacking the oppression narrative. They'll just think you're full of hate. For example, if you talk about race and intelligence, and you're telling them about this stuff, they might go, why do you know about this? What motivates you to say this stuff? Right? Well, that's why you have to bring up the anti-white institutional racism. Right? It's the casus belli for this stuff. Right? It explains that, no, I'm not just a hater. I'm, in fact, reacting to aggression against me because I'm white. And if you don't explain the systemic anti-white racism, they won't understand why you're attacking the oppression narrative, and they'll think you're a bad person for doing so. But if you don't attack the oppression narrative and all you do is point out the anti-white racism, then there's a good chance they just straight up won't see anything wrong with the anti-white institutional racism. Or if they do, they'll go, well, maybe we've gone a little far and we need to tone it back. Maybe we need to reduce affirmative action or something like that. They'll have this. They'll still support it. They'll still support it in principle. They'll just say, "Oh, well, you brought up stuff that may go a little bit too far, right?" It's not a robust and vigorous fundamental opposition, right? If all you bring up is the anti, so you need both. You need both. You need to undermine the oppression narrative, and you need to tell people why you're undermining the oppression. Okay, and race and IQ is a big part of attacking that oppression narrative. Now it's almost like half the battle, half the scope of what it's talking about when undermining the oppression narrative. So if you're saying no to IQ charts, well, what are you replacing them with? And the answer from these people is nothing. If you're attacking IQ and you're basically taking away a weapon and it's being replaced with nothing. That's JF's plan. Because you have to set your arguments apart. And there are two ways to do that. You can appeal to moral outrage, or you can appeal to facts that the other person can't avoid. Now, for me, I prefer to appeal to what I think of as unavoidable facts, which is probably the less effective of the two strategies. It's probably more effective to appeal to moral outrage. So a legitimate criticism against me is that I don't appeal to moral outrage enough, which is something I'm trying to change. But that said, I don't think it's really that much of a case of which one is more effective than the other, as much as it's the case that you need both, right? It's kind of like saying, you know, which is more important for a car to run, you know, the engine or the suspension and tires, right? Like, well, you need both, okay? They both work together, right? You need the moral outrage. You need to point to the anti-white institutional racism, tell them why you're doing this to create the motivation for undermining the oppression narrative, right? And you have to undermine the oppression narrative in order to point out that the anti-white institutional racism is really a rank and base humiliation that is not justified at all, right? So you need both. And I think I've been a little bit too focused on the facts side of things and not enough focused on the moral outrage side of things. And you need both. And I'm going to try to move in that direction after this Guns, Germs, and Steel video. But to the Evola Fausts, right, their whole might makes right philosophy and their life is struggle and war or whatever, well, that whole thing prevents you from making any kinds of appeal to moral outrage. Oh, anti-white institutional racism? Okay, well, you said something to the effect of might makes right, right? That's what you say, right? The world is a world of force and an endless struggle and the nobility of war. Well, okay, you lost the struggle. And that philosophy that also makes them, first off, less likely to try to undermine the oppression narrative because they don't necessarily see anything wrong about enslaving or conquering or otherwise oppressing people because, you know, endless struggle and all that. But on top of that, they have poo-pooed and pathologized people who use a lot of statistics. So not only does their philosophy make them disinclined to attack the oppression narrative, their subculture pushes them away from assembling and analyzing the statistics necessary to undermine the oppression narrative. So it's a double whammy that not only are they philosophically disinclined, but they're to undermine the oppression narrative, right? Because they support oppression, but their subculture steers them away from the use of statistics that are necessary to undermine the oppression. So all this kind of Evola Faust fascist philosopher swill, it just renders you impotent from an activist standpoint. And it also just looks kind of pathetic. And of course, Richard Spencer is like the chief manifestation of this. He can't appeal to anti-white oppression narrative. Excuse me, he can't appeal to anti-white institutional racism, right? He has to, I don't know, sort of appeal to, like, become who you are and this sort of aspirational sort of stuff, that doesn't work. It's far less effective than grievance, right? Ethnic grievance has just proven time and time again to be far more effective than being an aspirational leader. That's just the fucking truth. Okay. And of course, and then he, on top of that, talks about how the IQ charts people were trying to lead the white nationalist movement to just endlessly promote their IQ charts and never go forward. And it's like, well, we've seen the effect of deviating from that. I mean, first, when talking about any kind of activist strategy, first do no harm. All right. But anyway, but the thing is, I'm doing it again, right? I recognize sort of at a conscious level and a cognitive level that I am not of these people, that I'm not a white nationalist, that I'm not of any of these, of Richard Spencer. You know, increasingly, like, if you just did sort of a checklist of what exactly I agree with these people on, it gets very small and so it's like, why am I so concerned about the bad strategies of white nationalists? And why am I so concerned about bad strategies of the alt-right? Because it's like, well, you know, I'm not a white nationalist. I'm not particularly anti-Jewish. I'm pro-Israel. What are some similarities? Hereditarianism and race and IQ. But the thing is, those similarities are starting to go away. Is it seems like they're leaving hereditarianism and race and IQ. It seems that not the TDS people, but you know, people like JF and Richard Spencer, and I don't know about Daily Storm, but it seems like there's this sort of movement away from racial hereditarianism and towards what, I don't know, some kind of spiritual race crap. I don't exactly know where they're drifting towards, but it's somewhere stupid and it has nothing to do with me. Okay, so they're and they're increasingly like anti-IQ. They're opposed to bringing up anti-white institutional racism. Like what? So I have to ask myself, why am I still chafed at their tactical incompetence when I'm not on their team? Why am I still chafed at their tactical incompetence if I'm not on their team? Well, I guess maybe to some degree I still see myself as being on their team. You know. Maybe in sort of a cognitive level I've made the break, but at some other level I haven't fully made the break. Whatever. That's a little bit too much navel gazing here. So I gotta end this video somewhere, you know, why not here?